Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents How a Realist Hero Rebuilt the Kingdom, Volume 2, by Dojyomaru. Narrated by B.J. Harrison. Prologue, On Your Side. Licia, hold these documents for me. Souma said.
Okay, got it, I responded.
Lately, Souma had been acting strangely. As I took the stack of documents from Souma, a thought occurred to me. Recently, Souma had been working on paperwork with even greater zeal and enthusiasm than before. It was as if we'd returned to that time shortly after my father had abdicated the throne to him. He shouldn't have been as busy now as he was back then, but it seemed to me as if he was seeking out work and packing in more of it than he reasonably could. And yet when he suddenly found himself with free time, he didn't do anything in particular, just stared vacantly out the window. Before, when he'd had free time, he would have come to my room and worked on dolls or on cute outfits to dress Tomoe up in. But he didn't even do that lately. I watched Souma silently processing documents. The change was a subtle one, and I was sure that hardly anyone else in the castle would have noticed it. I started to speak.
Hmm? Is something the matter?
Having noticed my eyes on him, Souma looked up. I said, No, it's nothing. With just those words, I turned around and walked out of the governmental affairs office.
Hey, Licia.
I could hear Soma's voice from behind me, but I couldn't bring myself to turn back. Or rather, I couldn't bear to look at Souma as he was now. That night, Junadoma came to my room.
So, Princess, His Majesty's behavior is strange. That was what you wanted to talk about, right?
She asked, tilting her head to the side questioningly. I had called out to her as she was preparing for a Jewel voice broadcast program, and I had her come back to my room when the broadcast finished. I was grateful that when I told Juna that there was something strange about the way Souma had been acting, she had come with me, despite the late hour. Have a seat, Juna. I sat on the bed, gesturing for Juna to sit next to me.
Excuse me,
Juna said, taking her seat next to me. I got down to business. I don't know how to say it. He seems distracted. Sometimes it seems he's more absorbed in his work than ever, but the next thing I know, his head is off in the clouds, and he's staring vacantly outside.
I see. I think I can understand, if only a little.
Perhaps Juna had some insight as to what was going on, because she nodded with a mysterious look on her face.
I've seen the same. When I had a meeting with His Majesty about our broadcast program, his mind seemed to be elsewhere, though I couldn't tell you how long he's been like this.
I think it's been since we came back from the God-protected forest, I said. It had been just 2 weeks ago. A landslide had struck the home of the Dark Elves, the God-protected forest, which was also the homeland of Soma's bodyguard, Aisha Utgard. Souma had led the unit he was with at the time to carry out a relief effort. When notice of the disaster arrived, I had been asked to come back to the capital to call in reinforcements, so I hadn't personally participated in the rescue operation. Souma, however, had been there with Halbert, Kaida, and the other Forbidden Army soldiers, carrying out relief operations in that hellscape of a disaster zone. I felt like that was the point when Souma had started acting strangely. Maybe it was after that relief effort that he started to act strangely. After all.
But I heard that His Majesty accomplished a great deal while he was there, Juna said.
Yeah, I agreed. I think he did a good job there, too. I'd heard that he'd used his ability, living poltergeists, to control wooden mice, and had had them search under the dirt and sand, helping to find many people who'd been buried alive. However, but that's not how Souma feels about it. Maybe it's because he saw so many bodies, he thinks, couldn't I have handled things better?
I don't think it's bad, in and of itself, for him to think that way, though.
Juna had a complicated expression on her face. It was important to reflect on things. However, excessive reflection could lead to self-hatred, and that would be counterproductive.
That's exactly why I want you to encourage him for me.
I took Juna's hand, placing my own over it. Juna's eyes went wide.
You want me to?
You're about the only person I can ask to do something like this. Aisha's still in the God-protected woods, and Tomoe's still little. Even so, if I were to ask Mother or Serena, they aren't close enough with him.
But if that's the case, wouldn't you yourself be an even better choice to do it, Princess?
She asked.
The two of you are betrothed, and I can see that you're concerned for him.
I can't be the one, I said, lowering my eyes. I'm younger than Souma, so he probably thinks, as a man, I don't want to show her my weaknesses. When he's in front of me, Souma puts up a strong front.
I'm the same age as His Majesty, too, you realize?
You may be the same age, but the way you act is more mature, I said. I think you would do a fine job of indulging a young boy who's trying to put up a strong front. As I sat up straight, Juna bowed her head. That's why, Juna, I finished. That's why I'm asking you to take care of Souma for me.
Princess, I understand. I may not be of much help, but allow me to do all that I can.
Juna said, bringing a hand to her chest and nodding. After leaving Licia's chambers, Juna went to the governmental affairs office, which doubled as Soma's room. Things were hectic here during the day, with all the bureaucrats coming and going. But late at night, it was quiet enough to make the memory of all that daytime hustle and bustle seem like a lie. Two guards who were there to protect Souma stood on either side of the door.
Right. Aisha isn't here, Juna thought. That's to be expected, considering.
It wasn't the case that Aisha stayed by Soma's side 24/7, but she was with him often enough that it felt unnatural to not see her there protecting him. Juna walked up to the door, giving a slight nod to the guards. Perhaps Licia had already spoken to the guards, as they made no attempt to stop Juna.
It's a bit late to bring it up now, but it's a rather bold move for the princess to be sending a lady to her betrothed's chambers late at night.
After leaving a man and woman alone at night, what did she intend to do if something were to happen? Did she believe nothing would happen? Or was it that even if something were to happen, she was prepared to accept it if that cheered Souma up?
Somehow I get the sense that it's the latter.
Juna let out a sigh of admiration. Lately, when she looked to Licia, there were times when she could see a queenly dignity in her. When her sudden betrothal to Souma had first been decided, there had been some awkwardness between the two of them. But now, she seemed to have accepted the reality of the situation.
She's truly a magnificent individual.
For each day she spent with Souma, Licia grew a little more attractive as a woman. Someday she would make a splendid queen, as well as a good wife and a wise mother. Juna couldn't help but respect her as a fellow woman.
The princess asked this of me personally. I, too, must do my duty.
Firming up her resolve a little more, she gently knocked on the door to the governmental affairs office and called,
Your Majesty? It is Juna Doma. Are you still awake?
She kept her voice low enough that, were he already asleep, she would not disturb him. Juna, come in, she heard Souma say from inside the room. When Juna opened the door with a,
Pardon me,
and entered, she found Souma looking through some paperwork by candlelight. Souma laid the document down on the desk, turning a somewhat wearied smile to Juna. What is it, so late at night? Are you sleeping over at the castle?
Yes, I am, Juna said. It's been decided that I'll be staying in the princess's room tonight.
Having a girls-only party? That sounds like fun.
When he gave her that frank and unguarded response, while Juna may not have been lying, she still felt guilty.
No. Anyway, what are you up to, sire? I had heard you were finished with your government work for the day.
I did lie down to go to bed, but I just couldn't get to sleep, so I started looking through the papers I was going to go over tomorrow. I figured maybe it would help me feel a little more sleepy, Souma said, glancing to the stack of papers on his desk. Juna could see the tiredness in his expression.
Could it be you're not sleeping lately?
Juna asked.
Souma scratched his head a little awkwardly. My body's tired, but my mind just won't let me get to sleep, you know? When I close my eyes and try to sleep, I end up thinking about all sorts of things. About everything I've done, about everything there still is to do, about whether the decisions I've made were right, about whether the decisions I'm going to make are right. It all whirls around inside my head, and I just can't get to sleep.
Souma gave a weak laugh. Juna remembered that ever since Souma had been summoned to this world, he had been forced to carry many heavy burdens. Getting the country back on its feet, resolving the food crisis, and providing relief to the disaster area. Any one of these would have been too heavy for Souma, who had been a student until just recently. And now, this time, he needed to find a solution to the friction between him and the three dukes, along with the problem of the Principality of Amidonia's maneuvering in the shadows. All that pressure must have been keeping him up at night. When that occurred to her,
"Oh, pardon me a moment."
Juna took Soma's hand and had him stand up.
"Huh? Hold on, what?"
He stumbled. Paying no mind to the flustered Souma, Juna pulled him by the hand, tugging him over to the simple bed set up in a corner of the room, then pushing him down on it with a thud. As Souma lay there, eyes wide, having just been laid down on the bed, Juna spoke to him in a quiet tone.
"Please, sleep."
"Huh? It's Juna."
"Please, just sleep."
Juna, who always wore a warm smile, had an unusual expression on her face. It was like one she might use to scold a naughty little brother, stern, yet at the same time full of concern for the person she was talking to.
"I know things are difficult, but please take care of yourself. Princess Licia is worried too."
"Licia is?" he asked.
"Yes. She saw right through your front, sire. She knew something was wrong and sent me here. She asked me to do my best to indulge you."
"Well, darn."
Souma looked up at the ceiling, a wry grin on his face.
"I had thought I was working hard and doing my best, you know."
"You are working hard, sire. However, you work too hard."
Juna sat down on the edge of the bed, resting a hand on Soma's forehead. He could feel Juna's cool hand robbing his forehead of warmth. While enjoying that pleasant sensation, Souma closed his eyes. As she watched Souma, Juna began to sing quietly.
"Go to sleep for tonight. Sleep until tomorrow. When you wake, walk. When you tire, sleep. The longer you walk, the more hands there will be to support you."
It wasn't a song from Soma's world, but a lullaby from this one. A song mothers sang to children who had learned to walk. A song that prayed that they would walk a lot, sleep a lot, and grow up healthy. However, the line, "The longer you walk, the more hands there will be to support you," touched Soma's heart, bringing forth tears. Souma put his arm over his eyes, hiding them.
"Sorry for letting you see me look so uncool."
Juna smiled.
"It's okay for you to whine now, because I too am on your side."
As she said that, She gently stroked Soma's head.
I can understand why you don't want to look bad in front of the princess, she told him, letting her gentle voice stroke Soma's ears. It's because of those feelings that you're able to work hard and try to be strong. However, when you grow tired from that, call me. On the nights you can't sleep, let me be there to sing for you.
Not long after, Juna heard his shallow breaths as he drifted off to sleep. His body and mind were both more than exhausted enough for it. He must have fallen asleep the moment his heart had been set at ease. Juna rose from the bed, checked that Souma was fully asleep, and pulled a blanket over him. Then she headed for the door to make a silent departure, reached for the handle, and suddenly she stopped. Juna made a U-turn back to the bed, pulling the hair hanging over her ear back. She brought her face to Soma's ear and quietly whispered, It's okay. I am on your side. If the princess brings out your strengths, then I will hide your weakness.
Chapter 1. A Sign. In the middle of the ninth month, 1546th year, continental calendar. In Elfrieden, where the four seasons were especially distinct, even compared to the other continental nations, the lingering heat of summer had faded, and it was now a more temperate season. The season of bountiful harvests, when this country's food crisis was expected to be resolved. Even with that season lying before them, there was still an air of unease hanging over the kingdom. The source of that unease lay in the opposition between the new king, Souma Kazuya, and the three dukes. Souma, who was said to have been summoned from another world as a hero, had had his potential recognized by the former king, Albert Elfrieden, who had then ceded the throne to him. With support from the daughter of the former king, Lysia, who became Soma's betrothed, Souma moved to enrich the state and strengthen the military. He gathered a diverse variety of gifted personnel, solved the food crisis, set up a transportation network, and got involved in disaster prevention. It all might have been a little plain for one called a hero, but his stable reign had the support of the populace. The three dukes, on the other hand, were the three people who controlled the kingdom's land, air, and sea forces. General of the Elfrieden Kingdom Army, Duke Georg Carmine, who was a lion beastman. Admiral of the Elfrieden Kingdom Navy, Duchess Excel Walter, who was a sea serpent. General of the Elfrieden Kingdom Air Force, Duke Castor Vargas, who was a dragon newt. These three had protected the kingdom for many long years, but they were still not loyal to the new king, Souma, and they had taken their forces and were secluding themselves in their own territories. It was unclear what each of their intentions were, but of the three dukes, Army General Carmine had given shelter to nobles being investigated by Souma for corruption, and he was taking a clearly defiant stance. The new king Souma and Army General Georg Carmine. People believed it was only a matter of time before the two came into conflict.
Listen, Souma, Lysia told me. In this world's wars, it's coordination between the land and air forces that's important.
It was a day that, with things gradually growing chilly, you could really feel that it was now autumn. On this day, I was having Lysia teach me about wars in this world. As the inevitable conflict with Jorg, who was sheltering corrupt nobles, and Amidonia, who were maneuvering in the shadows, drew ever closer, I wanted to at least have a sense for what the flow of battle would be like. Of course, as a total amateur, I wouldn't be commanding troops. When the war came, I would probably end up leaving control of my personal forces, the Forbidden Army, to the captain of the Royal Guard, Ludwin. Even so, as the king, and thus the one who had to decide whether or not to open hostilities, I felt I should know these things,
and so I was having Licia teach me. Though she was royalty, she had graduated from the officer's academy and was knowledgeable enough on military matters that Ludwin had said of her, "While she lacks the experience to lead a large army, she has courage and would have no trouble leading a smaller army." Honestly, I just wanted a rough outline of how a skirmish would go, so she could have kept it simple. But Licia was too serious for that. She'd even prepared a blackboard to draw diagrams on as she explained things, turning this into something like a lecture at officers' school. Licia drew two circles on the board, labeling them "Our Army" and "Enemy Army." She also wrote the words "Land Force" and "Air Force" in both circles. Here, I should caution you about one thing. What was meant by a land force or air force here was different from what you would expect on Earth. The wars in this world were still fought by knights in armor, so if you were looking at just the style, it was similar to the Hundred Years' War. However, in this world, there was magic, and there were fantastic creatures like wyverns. In the land forces, there weren't just infantry, cavalry, and archers. There were also mages. And as for the Air Force, it wasn't made up of fighter planes. It was made up of wyvern knights, who fought on the backs of great flying lizards. Because of that, the flow of battle naturally ended up being different than on Earth. "I'm not familiar with naval battles, so this will only cover land battles, okay?" Licia said. "First, in a field battle, the air and land forces of both camps will begin to fight at practically the same time." Licia first drew arrows from the two land forces and had them ram into one another. "The battle between land forces is orthodox. It starts with long-range fire from archers and mages, and then, when the enemy formation breaks, infantry advance and push in. Knights and cavalry look for openings, charging in small numbers to disrupt the enemy's formation, or massing in larger numbers to charge the enemy, followed by infantry in order to tear the enemy unit apart. We call the former tactic cutting and the latter breaking." That's probably pretty similar to the battles in your world, right? "Well, we don't hurl spells back and forth, but aside from that, I think it's the same," I said. Somehow it called to mind memories of watching the battle scenes in the Taiga drama series. "It started with an exchange of fire, using the matchlock rifle and bow and arrow. Then, when the Ashigaru foot soldiers were given the order to charge, they advanced through rifle fire, even as they were shot down, to reach the enemy's fence. Because it was hard to use ranged weapons to deal with enemies once they were allowed to close in, the defenders would send out their own unit of Ashigaru soldiers. And from there, the two units of Ashigaru would slug it out. Because this world hadn't developed firearms, it might be easiest to think of magic as a replacement for matchlocks." Next, Licia drew arrows from the two air forces, having them ram into one another too. "And at the same time as the two land forces are colliding, the air forces will crash into one another too. If they can seize the airspace over the battlefield, the wyvern cavalry can fly at altitudes that arrows can't reach to drop gunpowder barrels, a sort of bomb. After all, that's brutal," I said. It was like the fear and the pain that came from being punched, with no way to fight back. "In that case, is the key to victory or defeat in battle held by the Air Force then?" I asked. "No," she said. "The battle between air forces almost never decides the outcome of a battle." "Huh? But just now you said if you can gain control of the air, you can attack without there being any way for them to fight back." "Yes, I did. Which is precisely why the primary goal of the air battle is not to gain control of the air, but to keep the other side from gaining control of the air." Next, Licia wrote 1,000 next to the air force of our army and 500 next to the enemy's. "Wyvern knights are only a small fraction of the overall army. In the Elfrieden kingdom, there are 1,000 knights, and in the Principality of Amidonia, around 500 knights.
Now, hearing that, you might think in a straight-up fight, our side would win. But the enemy know they're at a numerical disadvantage. They won't actively try to go on the offensive. They're going to stick purely to defense. If we try to force the attack, we'll take heavier losses. It takes a lot of time to raise a single wyvern knight, so we don't want to take those losses. Ah, I think I've got a sense of it. Basically, in a field battle, the Air Force's job is to guard the air until the battle between the two land forces is decided, right? You've got it. Well, if our Air Force is considerably more powerful than the other countries, there are times when things can be decided by just the air battle, though. Licia turned to the map of the continent on the blackboard and pointed to the big country on the western edge, the Grand Chaos Empire. Then she pointed to the Star Dragon mountain range in the center and to the Nothung Dragon Knight Kingdom in the north. The Grand Chaos Empire has Air Force units that are organized not around wyverns, but another type of mount called griffins. When you say griffins, they're the ones with the head of an eagle and a body that's like a lion with wings, right? Yeah, she said. They can't fly continuously for as long as wyverns do, but they can make tight turns in midair, and they can overpower wyverns in a fight. On top of that, the Empire has a large number of wyverns, too. That makes them dangerous. From what I was hearing, wyverns were like bombers, while griffins were like fighters. Both had strengths and weaknesses depending on how they were used, but when it came to a battle, fighters, which could make tighter turns, would be the stronger of the two. While I was sitting there satisfied with my own explanation, Licia continued on. Next, the Star Dragon Mountain Range and Nothung Dragon Knight Kingdom have dragons. Now that you mention it, I think I heard about them when we found the dragon bones at the sedimentation pool, I said. Dragons had a degree of magical power that was incomparably higher than what wyverns had. They were intelligent, they understood human language, and apparently they could even take on human form. While they didn't fall under the classification of mankind, they had a pact of mutual non-aggression with mankind, and had built a country of their own in the Star Dragon mountain range. In terms of appearance, while wyverns had wings in place of their forelegs, like pterosaurs, dragons had wings, but they also had front legs and back legs, looking more like the Western conception of dragons on Earth. North of the Star Dragon Mountain, in the Nothung Dragon Knight Kingdom, there are dragon knights who formed contracts with dragons from the Star Dragon Mountain Range, Licia said. A dragon knight takes a dragon as their partner, and in exchange for helping them to produce offspring, the dragon lends them their strength on the battlefield. Basically, they get married to the dragons. Can I think of them like an upgraded version of the Wyvern Cavalry? I asked. They're similar, but dragon knights are an order of magnitude more powerful. When a dragon and its knight become husband and wife, they're in perfect sync with one another. Even 1,000 soldiers from the land force would be no match for them. I hear they even managed to turn back an invasion by the Empire when it was at its peak once, even with the Empire's griffin units. Well, they definitely have the strongest air force then, I said. So they went into battle like a married couple running a 3-legged race. No, in their case, I guess it would be a 5-legged race. By the way, dragon newts, like Air Force General Castor Vargas, were a race born from the union between those dragons and their knights. When a child was born to a dragon and knight, it might be a dragon, it might belong to the knight's race, or it might be a dragon newt. There was no way to predict which it would be. It was totally random. On the other hand, a dragon couldn't be born from a dragon newt. And if a dragon newt married someone of another race, there was a 50-50 chance a dragon newt would be the result. So they were fairly numerous. Wait, huh? Why did we start talking about this again? I asked. Because we were talking about how it's hard for wyvern cavalry to be the deciding factor in battle. Remember? Licia stared at me, appalled. Oh, right, that was it.
Next, Licia drew a picture of a castle on the blackboard. That's a trend that becomes especially apparent in castle battles. At first glance, you might think the Air Force could fly over castle walls, directly attacking the castle and town, but it's actually impossible. Why is that? I asked. Because there are what you could call Air Force killers, anti-air repeating bolt throwers, installed on the castle walls. According to Licia, from practically the moment Wyvern Knights first came into this world, there had been research into countermeasures against them. That was because if the Wyvern Knights were allowed to fly over the walls as they pleased, it was a threat to the security of the state. In order to counter the Wyvern cavalry, the anti-air repeating bolt thrower had been invented. Inside a large rectangular box, there were small compartments, like a honeycomb, and in each of them was a thick, stake-like bolt. The bolts had their flying distance extended with attached spells, and they would also trace anything moving in the air. The anti-air repeating bolt thrower could fire dozens of these bolts simultaneously. If any wyvern carelessly got too close to the wall, the bolts fired by the anti-air repeating bolt throwers would attack them like homing missiles. That's why, in order to bomb a city, it's first necessary to attack the castle walls from ground level and destroy the bolt throwers, Licia explained. Up until that point, the Air Force's job is just to guard the air above the land force. I see. Castle battles are like a three-way deadlock, I said. Land forces were beaten by air forces. Air forces were beaten by bolt throwers, and bolt throwers were beaten by ground forces. It was because of those interrelated strengths and weaknesses that Licia said coordination between the air and land forces was important. Basically, setting aside the Navy for the moment, in the present situation, where we don't have a land or air force, if the Principality of Amidonia were to invade, we would have no way to deal with them, huh? Licia was silent. The Elfrieden Kingdom had a total manpower of around 100,000 troops. To break that down, the king's personal army, the Forbidden Army, had over 40,000. 40,000 in the army, led by Duke Georg Carmine. 10,000 in the navy, led by Duchess Axel Walter. 1,000 in the air force, led by Duke Castor Vargas. First, when it came to the king's personal army, the Forbidden Army, in reality, only around 10,000 of those troops could be mobilized. Publicly, the Forbidden Army was said to be more than 40,000 strong, but those numbers had included mercenaries dispatched by the mercenary state, Zem, as well as the personal forces of nobles not attached to the army, navy, or air force. Of those, I had already terminated our contract with the Zemish mercenaries. This was partly to save expenses, and partly because of Machiavelli's advice against trusting mercenaries. On top of that, while things might be different in a battle against Amidonia, in the upcoming conflict between myself and the three dukes, many among the nobility were going to be fair-weather allies. If it actually came to war against the three dukes, I probably wouldn't be able to count on using their personal forces. As such, the number of troops I could deploy would be only 10,000 or so, made up of the Royal Guard and the forces I controlled directly. My directly controlled army was almost entirely made up of infantry. 800 members of the Royal Guard were heavy cavalry. But because I had put them to work on infrastructure projects recently, all of them also had the skills required to be combat engineers. Furthermore, in my personal forces, there were also 500 earth mages, like Kayada. Now, as for the three dukes, if I were to give you the quick rundown, this is what it looked like. First, there were the 10,000 in the Navy. Most of these were the crew of battleships, cruisers, destroyers, or torpedo boats. There were only about 2,000 Marines who could go ashore and fight. So even if we had to fight them, because it would be on land, they weren't much of a threat. However, their admiral, Duchess Axel Walter, warranted caution. She was an incredible woman, possessing not only wisdom and courage, but political savvy as well. I'd heard that she had overcome the food crisis that had struck the whole kingdom using her own independent plan. If I made an enemy of her, she would probably come up with surprising ways to take advantage of my weaknesses, even from outside the battlefield. Personally, of the three dukes, she was the one I least wanted to make an enemy of. In contrast, the Air Force had a leader who would be easy to handle, and soldiers who would be dangerous to fight. Each of their soldiers generally came paired with a wyvern, and there were around 1,000 of these wyvern cavalry. Wyvern knights were every bit as strong as Licia had explained earlier. With the Forbidden Army having only a few wyverns used for relaying messages, it would be hard to fight them straight up. Air Force General Castor Vargas was a dragon newt, and it was no exaggeration to say that he was a peerless warrior. Also, being a dragon newt, even without a wyvern, he could fly using his own wings. He was hot-blooded, impulsive, and had a distaste for using any sort of petty tricks. While his actions would be easy to read, he had a tendency to put his beliefs before his own interests. So if I were to attempt to persuade him based on what was to his advantage, he was the one that would be least likely to work on. Finally, we were left with the 40,000 in the land forces, but both the general and his troops were going to be troublesome. While the simple number of soldiers they had was already impressive, their equipment and overall quality was like an upgraded version of what I saw in the Forbidden Army and my directly controlled forces. In addition to infantry and cavalry, there was also a siege weapon unit, and the firepower provided by their fire mages would be on another level. This was truly an army built to play the main role in a war. The man leading this army corps, General Georg Carmine, was a fierce commander and veteran of many battles. While his martial prowess was no less than Castor's, he didn't just rely on that. He was the rare warrior who could make level-headed decisions backed up by past experience. Honestly, I didn't want to make an enemy of him any more than I did Duchess Walter, but it didn't look like he had any intention of backing down. He had sheltered the nobles I was investigating for corruption and was clearly positioning himself for a confrontation. From what I had been told by Hal's father, Glaive Magna, there were many nobles and knights in the army faction who had left Duke Carmine over doubts about the position he was taking. But his forces were bolstered by the personal soldiers of the corrupt nobles he was sheltering, as well as Zemish mercenaries that he had hired. So there was no real change in the numbers. 40,000 in the army versus 10,000 in the Forbidden Army. If fought, the enemy would have 4 times our number. 4 times our number. Those are numbers where Sun Tzu would say to either flee or avoid the battle, I said.
Sun Tzu?
Licia asked. A military strategist from my old world. The name Sun Tzu refers to Sun Wu, he wrote The Art of War, who served the King of Wu during the spring and autumn period of Chinese history, or to his descendant, Sun Bin, he wrote Sun Bin's Art of War, who served King Wei of Xi during the Warring States period. They were both excellent strategists, and The Art of War and Sun Bin's Art of War are both excellent books on military strategy. When I explained that to her, Licia looked at me dubiously.
Souma, you were a student, right? Were you reading books on military strategy?
Yeah, because I liked history, I said. It was related to my interest in that. I had especially liked reading Records of the Grand Historian, Romance of the Three Kingdoms, and books about the Warring States period in Japan. As an offshoot of that, I had read both The Art of War and Sun Bin's Art of War, because both Sun Tzu's appear as characters in Records of the Grand Historian. If you read them, they're actually quite interesting. Like Machiavelli, they lived in turbulent times, and in their work, they accepted that this is just the way humans are. And so they discussed how best to deal with the unending wars.
Both became famous through war, but that wasn't to say that they were bellicose men. Both of them spoke against easily resorting to war. Sun Wu had said, "To break the enemy's resistance without fighting is best," in Sun Wu's strategic attack. And when giving counsel to King Wei, Sun Bin had said, "War is not a place for merriment," in Sun Bin's meeting King Wei. However, in a chaotic world, such platitudes wouldn't always be enough. If you didn't defend, didn't attack, the result would be that people died. Both Sun Tzu's understood that. Sun Bin said, "Even the great rulers of legend wanted to rule by morals, but they couldn't do that. That was why they had to subjugate evil kings by means of war. It's important to separate ideals from reality and to do the things that, realistically, you ought to do." "Even if I don't want to do it, I have to," I said, "because I'm the king now." "Huh? Souma?" Licia began to say. There was a knock at the door. "Come in," I called out, and my adopted little sister-in-law, Tomoe, poked her head out from the shadow of the door.
"Big brother Souma, Akuya is calling for you," she said.
It seemed that Tomoe had been sent by the Prime Minister, Hakuya, to come and call me. "Hakuya is?" I asked. "Got it. Well then, Licia, please teach me the rest next time." After making that request to Licia, I left the room to go see Hakuya.
"Is something wrong, big sister?" Tomoe asked.
As I stared vacantly at the door Souma had left through, my adopted sister spoke up, sounding concerned. Oh, that's no good, I thought. I can't go worrying such a little girl. "It's just, there was something that bothered me," I said.
"Something bothered you?"
Tomoe tilted her head to the side quizzically. She looked adorable the way she did it, which helped to calm me down a little bit. "You see, Souma," he said, "because I'm the king now."
"Big brother Souma is the king of this country, you know," she said.
"Well, yes, but I didn't think that the Souma I had known up until then would ever have said those words. Up until just recently, he'd said things like, 'I'm just holding on to the crown temporarily,' or, 'Once I've finished reconstructing this kingdom, I'll give it back to you, Licia.' Like I'd thought, taking part in the relief effort at the God-protected forest might have caused Souma to have a change of heart. Of course, I wanted Souma to be the king, and if he'd gained an awareness of his position, it should have been a good thing, but I don't know. For some reason, there's an uneasiness in my heart. I couldn't put it into words very well. There was a sort of premonition creeping into my breast. It felt as if Souma was slowly turning into someone he wasn't."
"Big sister, is big brother Souma strange?"
Tomoe was looking at me worriedly again. It seemed I'd had a gloomy look on my face again. I patted Tomoe on the head. "It'll all be okay. Soma's not alone. He has all of us with him, after all."
"Yes, he does."
Tomoe's little wolf tail was wagging about energetically. "Yes, that's right. No matter what future awaits, I will walk alongside you to the very end, Souma." Chapter 2. The Castes of Two Nations. Ninth month, 1546th year, continental calendar. Princely capital, Van. The city of Van, the princely capital of the Principality of Amidonia, was surrounded by high castle walls, and its architecture was without stylistic excess or ornamentation. Put in a flattering light, it could have been called austere and rugged. Termed less favorably, it was dull and monotonous. The unrefined scenery of this town closely resembled the people who inhabited it. This country, which had lost land in a war with Elfrieden 2 reigns ago, had made revenge on that kingdom a national policy.
What they valued above all else was the warrior ethos. Of their men, they demanded austerity. Of their women, they demanded servility to those men, as well as a feminine modesty. Because of that, there were no men laughing in the streets and no women promenading in fashionable outfits. That was the nature of the quiet city van. But recently there was a strange giddiness in the air. It had started when their neighboring country, the enemy kingdom of Elfrieden, had gone through a sudden change of leadership. In the 1546th year of the continental calendar, King Albert of Elfrieden had abdicated his throne. Albert, the now former king, had been a mediocre individual. But owing to his gentle nature, he had been respected by his vassals and the people. However, also owing to this gentleness, he had not implemented the drastic policies that would have rooted out the corruption of wicked vassals. Thanks to this, and a variety of other overlapping causes, the kingdom had fallen into a slow decline. This Albert had turned over his throne to a hero, said to have been summoned from another world. The hero was apparently named Souma Kazuya. At the same time as Albert had entrusted the throne to Souma, he had also arranged for the betrothal of his only daughter Lysia to the new king, ensuring Soma's hold on power. This Souma, who the throne had been turned over to, had yet to be formally crowned, but he was, in effect, the king, and had embarked on a series of political reforms. With this sudden change of kings, there had been those who had suspected usurpation at first, but with the support of Lysia, he had righted the wrongs of his vassals, gathered new personnel, improved the food security situation during a time of shortages, and installed a domestic transportation network to boost shipping capacity. With the steady implementation of these policies and more, Souma was gathering the support of the people. For a hero, he was rather plain, but as a king, he was superb. That was the people's appraisal of him. However, Soma's reign was not to be smooth sailing in all aspects. First, the three dukes who controlled the land, air, and sea forces of Elfrieden, there was also a force other than these, the Forbidden Army, which served the king directly, had still not sworn loyalty to Souma. The Lion Beastman, who was general of the army, Georg Carmine. The Sea Serpent, who was admiral of the navy, Axel Walter. The Dragon Newt, who was general of the air force, Castor Vargas. Ever since the change of kings, these three had taken their armies and secluded themselves in their own territories. Because this was all taking place in another country, their exact intentions remained unknown, but it was clear that their relations with Souma were strained. In particular, there were rumors that the general of the army, Georg Carmine, had been gathering forces in his territory, making his position in opposition to Souma clear. In addition, the nobles who had been investigated by Souma for corruption were pushing back against him. Those engaged in serious wrongdoing had been stripped of their titles and had their lands and assets seized. Those whose crimes were even more severe were to be jailed or otherwise punished. The corrupt nobles were not happy about this and had attempted to take their assets and flee the country. However, the borders had already been sealed, and with no other alternative, they had gathered under Georg Carmine, who was in open opposition to Souma. Thus, with the discord between Souma and the three dukes rising to the surface, the citizens of Amidonia were in high spirits. There were plausible rumors that King Souma had begun to raise troops to subjugate the three dukes who would not step back from their rebellious position. The kingdom was experiencing a conflict between the king and his vassals. This was a situation that had the Principality of Amidonia watering at the mouth. It looked like an unparalleled chance to pursue their national goals, to reclaim our stolen land, and take revenge against that kingdom. Because of that, among not only the soldiers, but the general populace as well, the overwhelming consensus was that now is the time to invade the kingdom. In this militaristic state, the army came first and the lives of the people second. Priority was given to the military when funding was handed out, meaning that the people did not become more prosperous. Of course, there must have been discontent from this, but the people were taught that all of our suffering is the fault of the Elfrieden kingdom, who stole our land. Rather than direct their anger towards the politicians or the army, instead, they directed it at the kingdom of Elfrieden. No matter how badly they were misgoverned, it was always that kingdom's fault. From a statesman's perspective, there could be no situation that was more ideal. Furthermore, this belief that that kingdom is responsible for our difficult lives led naturally to a belief that our lives will become better.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.